I'm so excited to talk about Force of Fire. I have an advanced copy that Scholastic sent me, and I started reading it. I will say I think it is a I'm going to call it classic Sayantani novel with you have a brand. It's super fun, magical world building, amazing voice, hilarious right off the bat, like right into the action right off the bat. But will you start us off by introducing the book and telling us about the book?
Sure, Christina. I'd be honored. And I'd also love to talk about your books because I'd love to have a, you know, conversation about the writing process. But so Force of Fire is a standalone middle grade fantasy adventure set in the same multiverse as the Kieran Mala novels, but it is a freestanding novel. So you can start with it having not read, you know, the other novels, Serpent's Secret or Game of Stars or The Chaos Curse. Or you can be a Kieran Mala fan and dive right in. This is the story of Pinky, who is a fire rakshasi. A rakshasi is a monster of sorts from Bengali folktales. And she doesn't really want anything to do with revolutions or do-goodery. She just wants to be able to control her a little bit out of control fire. She has a tendency of setting like classrooms aflame when she's upset. But when she makes a deal with Seisha, the son of the serpentine governor general, to do just that. And to put this in context, the serpents are the empire who are currently ruling and oppressing the country that she lives in. Pinky actually finds herself becoming the reluctant leader of a revolution against the snakes. And she discovers a way to be the spark of the kind of rebellion for freedom in her country. So that is Pinky's story.
So awesome. And she's such a great character. You just love her right away and connect with her right away. And you can tell that she's going to find her spark. Like she's going to find her voice later in the book. I'm excited to read about her. So, okay. So one thing that I have always admired about your writing is that your books are so fun. They're so accessible. Like they have all this like gross humor, like middle grade humor. And there's crushes and frenemies and friendships and all of the stuff that you love in middle grade and fantasy. But you're also always like probing these bigger themes, and you know, you're talking about big important questions. So I want to talk more about like your inspiration for this novel. And I've heard you talk about your family and their, you know, their history of struggle against oppression. So can you give us a little bit of insight and like why you set this story the way that you did?
Absolutely. I mean, like the Kieran Mala novels, Force of Fire is based on the Bengali folktales that my own grandmother and aunts would tell me on my long summer vacations to India. But what's unique about Force of Fire is that it's also really inspired by a lot of anti-colonial struggles. So be that the fact that my own grandfather and many other members of my family were involved in the Indian Revolution against the British. So, you know, for any young listeners or folks who don't know, the British Raj kind of ruled over the South Asian subcontinent for a good 200 years. And India and Pakistan achieved their freedom only in 1947. And so my own grandfather, when he was 15 years old, went to jail for a good 7 years, I think, for his activities in something called the Chittagong Armory Raid. It was one event in many events kind of rebellion against the British. And I was inspired by this idea of like, how much fire you have to have in your heart, in your belly, in your mind, in your soul about this amorphous idea called freedom, right? To at 15 years old say, you know what, I'm going to risk it all for my country, for my, you know, fellow brothers and sisters. I'm going to risk it all for justice. And that's kind of the bigger question that I was probing in my own head. In the novel, there are children who are actually caged up by the Serpentine Empire. human and rock push children who are taken from their families and who have their voices magically taken away from them so they can't speak. And this to me was an homage, not just to what's been happening in this country at the border, but also to kind of histories of language oppression and fights to preserve, you know, different communities' languages. In Bangladesh, it was the Pasha Andolan. Young people really fought and gave their lives to keep Bengali, Bangla, as the national language of just then forming Bangladesh. In this country, we see it in the US, you know, we see it in indigenous communities, Native American communities who are doing such an important and vital job keeping a hold and preserving their languages after the attempted erasure, right, of those languages through Native American boarding schools, you know, just a generation ago, kids being forced away from their families and put into these boarding schools where they weren't allowed to speak their own languages. And I just want to read like one quick line. One of the first people that starts to make Pinky think, huh, maybe being this selfish isn't exactly my path, is a prince, she later finds out, called Orko. But at the time, he's kind of masquerading as a school teacher. And when she sees him, he's teaching young human children how to read and write Bengali, their own language. And the kids are like, well, you know, why don't the snakes want us to speak Bangla, Shrujuga? One of the human school children asked. The teacher they called Brother Shrujuga smiled, poured some soil into the boy's hand, and then closed the child's small fist with his own. I know this might be hard to understand, but the thing is, destroying a people's language, not letting children learn the ways of those who came before them, is the surest way to kill a culture. So we could get in trouble for speaking our own language, even with our families? A worried-looking boy with cracked eyeglasses asked the teacher. Should we stop, speak more like them? Asked a dirty-faced little one, drawing out her S's like the snakes did. You can adapt. You can learn new things. The teacher was talking to the little girl who had been speaking like the snakes. A beam of sunlight shooting through the leafy canopy illuminated his features as he spoke. You can even leave behind some beliefs of your parents that don't serve you well. But you can never forget who you are or where you come from. That is your strength. That is the source of your real power. So
love it.
Those are like the, you know, there's fun and romp and adventure and humor. Mm-hmm. But I actually think fantasy is an amazing way to explore deeper, bigger topics like justice, right? Yes. Like freedom, like oppression. And what do we do about it?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I think that's like the legacy of great fantasy is that it's always, you know, subversive. It's always examining. It's like that's the advantage of fantasy is I think we can sometimes better look at our own world when we go into a completely different world, a completely magical world. At least that's how I felt.